In this video lecture, we'll give a short overview of classes and objects, which are the two central ideas in object-oriented programming. Okay, let's get started. Whenever you're trying to learn something new, it's always a good idea to begin with some clear definitions of the key ideas. So let's start with a class. A class is the fundamental building block in all of Java, and more generally in all object-oriented programming. As you'll see over and over again, everything you write in Java will be a class. A class is a template, or a blueprint, or a generic description of some real-world or abstract entity. It's a software thing or building block. A class bundles together in one place what that thing is, or how it's described, and what that thing does, or can have done to it. What that thing is represented by some handful of variables. What that thing does is represented by methods. So here we see all three types of software containers in one place. A class is a container for variables and methods, which in turn are themselves containers for data and instructions. The two primary characteristics of the class are what it is and what it does. These are represented in the software for a class by its fields, or more properly, its instance variables, and its methods. Other terminology that we'll often use interchangeably for this are its attributes or data versus its behaviors, or descriptions versus actions, or, to draw a writing analogy, its nouns versus its verbs. An object, by contrast, is just one specific instance of a class. It's like a new variable whose data type is simply that of its describing class. Remember that we said earlier that every variable needed to have some data type. Well, one way to think of a class is as a user-created new or extended data type above and beyond the eight fundamental data types we've already seen. The data values of an object are specific to that one particular instance of that class. For example, suppose we had a class named cat, and we decided that a cat could be adequately described by a name, a breed, an age, a birth date, and an owner. Then, in a nod to any Austin Powers fans out there, we might imagine there to be an object or a specific instance of the cat class named MyCat. As for the attributes of this specific cat, its name is Mr. Bigglesworth, its breed is a Persian, its age is 7, its birth date is 4/1/2008, and its owner, of course, is none other than Dr. Evil. Any other cat we might describe would have these same five general characteristics, but different values of them. So now that we've seen both classes and objects, what's the relationship between them? Classes and objects are the two central dual concepts in object-oriented programming. Classes are the general, and objects are the specific instances of them. A class is to an object as a blueprint is to a house, or a cookie cutter is to a cookie. We can use the same general class description to stamp out any number of specific class instances. For example, I live out in West Roseville, where there is all kinds of new home construction taking place. The same housing blueprint can be used to build numerous houses, but each house has its own distinctive address, paint scheme, and landscaping. My wife likes to bake with our kids, and she has a large collection of cookie cutters. The same cookie cutter can stamp out endless cookies, but each cookie is unique in terms of its flavor, frosting, and decorations. Now, usually at this point in my on-ground course, I like to bring out a plastic bin full of cookie cutters and then several boxes of Girl Scout cookies as visual aids to drive this point home, but alas, I can't do that here. Sorry. This table shows various examples of possible Java classes. For each class name on the left, several possible attributes and descriptions are shown. You as a designer might choose different attributes and behaviors, but these are just given for illustration. None of these are absolutes. They are simply chosen according to the designer's best judgment. Notice that some of these classes are very specific and concrete, while others are a bit more abstract. For example, we can easily picture the attributes for a dog and various things that a dog does. By contrast, a college course is much more abstract, yet it can still be described as a software thing with attributes and actions. It's also worth mentioning that these are the same examples we saw in an earlier video lecture, except note that now we are using good camel case naming for all variables and methods. Also notice that we are using parentheses to clearly designate all these on the right as methods. So now that we've initially defined what classes are, why do we use them in the first place? Well, it boils down to these three reasons: efficiency, encapsulation, and reliability. All of these are strong advantages in object-oriented programming. I like to think of code reuse as intelligent laziness. If we take the time up front to design and write a software class well, we can reuse it over and over again in other applications, thereby saving ourselves development time, effort, and cost. As the old saying goes, don't try to reinvent the wheel or boil the ocean. If you've already done it, just reuse it. Software which is well encapsulated into classes is easier to use because all the data and operations you need are bundled together in one place. This also makes it much easier to debug, maintain, and extend such code. Finally, we have the advantage of reliability when using classes. If some software component has already been built and tested and shaken out through prior use, it will tend to be much more reliable when reused in new software applications.